Citizen Kane is a movie that every true lover of film has to contend with. While its reputation as the greatest American film of all time precedes it, and indeed makes it a daunting project for more casual filmgoers to delve into, the fact is, director, producer, star Orson Welles wasn't necessarily trying to make art with it. He simply wanted to make a film that would entertain and perhaps push the medium in some ways. He was, after all, the consummate showman, even at age 24, and no one ever suffered more from Kane's reputation as the greatest film ever made than he. Everything he'd do afterwards would be scrutinized, and inevitably, critics would say, "It's no Citizen Kane." But then again, what was? But in the 80 years since it's come out, there's been some debate in scholarly circles about who was the true author of Citizen Kane, with Pauline Kael notoriously positing the theory that screenwriter Herman J. Mankiewicz was the true auteur, while Welles, at other times, said he was the sole writer of the screenplay. Whatever the case, the two shared screen credit, and sure enough, at the time, the only Academy Award the film took home was for the screenplay. David Fincher, working from a script by his late father Jack Fincher, seems to adhere to the notion that Citizen Kane was a deeply personal script by Mankiewicz, although the film doesn't posit to take anything away from Welles himself, who, after all, also starred in, produced, and directed the film. But, as far as Mank goes, Fincher makes it clear that Mankiewicz, as played by Oldman, wrote the screenplay as a way of exorcising some demons, with the film more about his relationship with William Randolph Hearst and Marion Davies, the two figures he based Kane on, than anything else. The result is a dazzling work that probably only would have ever been financed by Netflix at the level it's been made at, with them allowing Fincher a lavish budget to tell a Hollywood tale that makes no allowances for anyone not familiar with the period, meaning even some of his longtime fans may need to do a little research before putting this one in the queue. The film uses a flashback structure to juxtapose a laid-up Mankiewicz in 1940 writing the screenplay with a secretary, played by Lily Collins, who helps him while Welles' crony, John Houseman, who would later become famous as an older man acting in things like The Paper Chase and on TV's Silver Spoon, worries that the script will never get written. But the real meat and potatoes of the film comes through the lengthy flashbacks, depicting Herman's fabulously successful career as perhaps the greatest studio script doctor of all time, and a pseudo-court jester for Hearst, played by an uncanny Charles Dance. Mankiewicz becomes enamored with Hearst's longtime mistress, Marion Davies, played here by Amanda Seyfried in a potentially Oscar-worthy part. For those not in the know, Davies was a movie star, with many noting her exceptional comic gifts. She was a one-time protege of Charlie Chaplin, which itself got a dramatic treatment in the film The Cat's Meow. Her dreams of stardom as a comedienne were sidelined when Hearst decided to remake her as a quote-unquote important actress in dramatic roles, which, unfortunately, torpedoed her career. Oldman plays Mank as a bon vivant, happy to drink and gamble his way to oblivion as long as he's having fun while being enabled by his loving wife, who everyone dubs poor Sarah, and who's played by possessor's Tuppence Middleton. What puts him into conflict with Hearst is the gubernatorial campaign of socialist Upton Sinclair, who actually wrote the book Oil That There Will Be Blood was based on. Sinclair was running on an End Poverty in California campaign that would surely spell doom for all the money men in town, particularly Mank's patrons, Hearst and MGM studio head Louis B. Mayer, played here by a terrific Arliss Howard. He sees firsthand how these two use film to slant the election in favor of their chosen candidate, and worse, he enables them, leading to a lot of self-loathing and his eventual triumph redemption with Kane. Of course, there's much more to it than that, but Oldman contributes one of his finest performances ever, even if he's at least 20 years older than Mankiewicz was here. The thing is, if you look at vintage photographs of Mankiewicz, even when he was in his 30s, he looked like he was middle-aged. He did himself no favors by being an alcoholic and, of course, a gambler. People just did not take care of themselves back then like they do now. Surely Oldman is going to be at the top of everyone's list as a Best Actor contender of the Oscars this year. Fincher's style is also a knockout, filming everything as if this was a movie made in 1940, complete with cigarette burns from real changes and an evocative mono soundtrack that gives everything a faint echo. Even Atticus Rose and Trent Reznor contribute a score that's very atypical for them. You'll feel like you're sitting in a movie theater back in 1940, with only Fincher's decision to shoot in his usual 2:35:1 scope ratio being the contemporary giveaway. Well, that, of course, and some rampant F-bombs. Again, Mank is designed for movie aficionados, so if you're not interested in at least watching Citizen Kane before you watch this, you may as well not bother. It's probably not for you. But if you're game, you're going to be rewarded with a priceless glimpse into the history of the movies and the way they really can shape the world we live in for better or worse. I give this one a strong 9 on 10. And as a side note, if you see Mank and you find yourself intrigued by the story, buy the Citizen Kane Blu-ray set, which has a priceless documentary called The Battle for Citizen Kane that fills in a lot of the gaps as far as the story goes, as well as a star-studded HBO movie called RKO 281, which tells kind of the same story as Mank, but from Orson Welles' perspective, with Liev Schreiber playing the part and John Malkovich playing Mank. It's of course not a patch on Fincher's film, but it's interesting in its own merits.